is what we do.
So fast, so many things to say. Thank you, God. If it wasn't for your grace, I would not have come this far. I realize I needed you. I got joy on this Christmas day with my friends and my family. We share a common bond and it's love. Give us the very best. My life has now been blessed. I couldn't ask for anything better. You've been my strength and you've been my life. There was never a battle that I ever had to fight. So I wanna take the time and say that on this holiday, God has been so good, yeah. God has been so good, yeah. When I look back through the years, all the laughter, all the tears, I realize the reason for the season. Look at all the people who pass, their ribbons on their packages, joy is spread everywhere. There's a choir down on the corner trying to get somebody to join them as they sing. Jesus Christ, the one in the main, the spotlight is now on my saint. He is born to set us free. He is the greatest gift that has ever been given to man. And oh, 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 what a friend. Oh, 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 oh. He is my strength. He is my life. There has never been a battle that I've ever had to fight. So I wanna take the time to say, yeah, that every holiday, God has been so good to you. Yeah. God has been so good. Yeah. I got my family and friends together once again, and everybody knows the for the season. God has been so good to you. God has been so good to you. Say down through the years, on the laughter, on the tears, but we all know the reason for the season.
God has been so
what the herald angels see. Glory to the newborn King, yeah. Peace on earth and mercy mild. God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise. Come and join the triumph of the sky. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Oh, hark the herald angels sing. Sing glory to the newborn King. Heaven sing. Heaven-born Prince of Peace, say, Hail the Son of Righteousness, oh my, light and life to all He brings. Yes, He does. He's risen with healing in His wings. So mild He lay His glory by. He was born that man no more should die. Born to raise the sons of earth, He's born to give in second birth. Oh, hark the herald angels sing. Sing glory to the newborn King.
down on this side here.
Listen to what I say.
The child, sleeping.
on water. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would save our sons and daughters? Did you know that your baby boy has come to make you new? And this child sight to the blind man. Mary, did you know that your baby boy would calm the storm with his hand? Didn't you know that your baby boy has walked where angels try? And when you kiss your little baby, you kiss the face of God. Oh, Mary, did you know?
Son of Mary. and angels sing. Haste, haste to bring him, Lord, the babe, the Son of Man.
Hello and welcome out to our very special Cliffdale Christmas Cantata. We want to welcome everybody. If you're out in the foyer, go ahead and start making your way back in. We're going to go ahead and get started today. Hallelujah. You know, if you follow us, if you're following us virtually, thank you for being here. You know that we've been kind of going through the season of Advent. The very first week of Advent, we celebrated the hope that we find in Christ. The second week of Advent, we celebrated the peace that we find in Christ. The third week, last week, joy. And today we enter into our fourth and final week of Advent, where we celebrate the love with which Christ has loved us, that he so willingly came and gave his life for us. And so today we just say welcome and hope you have a blessed, wonderful Christmas, and enjoy this Christmas cantata. It's going to be a lot of fun. Let's do it.
Amen. Can you stand on your feet with us? Feel free to worship, you know, feel free. All right. Father God, we bless you, Lord. We thank you for this season. We thank you for allowing us to be here to worship you together, Lord God. We thank you for you, Lord God, being the greatest gift of all, Lord God. And we honor you today. We honor you for your presence. We honor you for your spirit. You are the King of Kings and you are the Lord of Lords. And we worship you today. In Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen. I'm going to do a few Christmas carols. I think y'all know the traditional ones. Maybe you don't. I don't know. You can join in at home as well.
Glory to the newborn King, peace on earth and mercy mild, God and sinners reconciled. Joyful all ye nations rise, join the triumph of the skies. With angelic hosts proclaim, Christ is born in Bethlehem. Hark the your glory reign, shining like the day. King of heaven, come.
King of heaven.
King of heaven, rise up. Who can stand against us? You are strong to save in your mighty name. King of heaven, come.
King of heaven.
King of heaven, come.
God is great and glorious.
Yeah. Come on.
We put our trust in your name, Jesus. Able to save and deliver us. We put our hope in your name, Jesus. Sing blessing,
blessing and honor, glory and power unto our God forever and ever. All of the honor, all of the praise is yours and yours, yours forever.
Steadfast, unmovable.
things impossible.
Honor you, Lord, because you reign. You reign on high. You're the King of Kings and you're the Lord of Lords. Like the song says, you're steadfast and you're unmovable. And we thank you for that. In your name, the highest name, Jesus' name. Amen, amen, amen.
How you guys doing today? Well, we just wanted to come and take some time to love on you guys a little bit. Is that okay? Can we do that today? So we just wanted to come on and tell you guys, we hope you guys have a wonderful holiday season. We hope you have a very Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year. And
yeah, can you believe this year is already like up and it's Christmas already?
Yes, this year has gone by slowly but fast.
Yes, and it has been a wild ride this year, hasn't it?
Yes, yes, this is a year for the yearbooks.
Mm-hmm. You know, Pastor Angie and I were just talking and we were talking about how, again, 2020 has just been such a crazy year. There's been so much bad news, you know, all year. It's like we've been just inundated day in and day out with bad news and bad news and bad news. And, you know, of course, front page is the virus. And because of it, so many other things have happened. You know, not only have people, you know, health-wise, you know, may not have made it, or may have ended up in a hospital, or may have lost their jobs, you know, and things like that. But through it all, one thing about it, you know, we said that even though it has been such a crazy year, we have so much
to be thankful for,
yes. to be grateful for.
Yes, so much to be grateful for.
So much to be, you know, Angie and I, we have seen, you know, and personally had, you know, miracles happen within our families,
friends,
you know, we have heard and again and seen so many of God's good works even through all of this, you know. And it reminds me, you know, when we talk about thankfulness, I go back to 1 Thessalonians 5:16-18, which says, rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And family, that's what we have to do. We have to be thankful and we have to rejoice and give thanks and be grateful at all times. And I know you're probably saying, well, Pastor Brian and Pastor Andrew, what does that have to do with Christmas? You wondering that? Well, I'm gonna tell you, here you go. Even though we have so many things that we could be ungrateful for and we could focus our attention on, the truth of the matter is this: we should be grateful in this time, because God our Father saw fit to give us a Savior.
Yes, amen.
And
all, you know, during this time, I think a lot of people lose focus of the true meaning of Christmas. Everybody is receiving gifts, getting gifts, you know. And I think that we forget about the gift giver himself.
Exactly.
So we forget about that, the true meaning of what Christmas is. Let us not forget why we celebrate Christmas. And it's not because of a Christmas tree. Well, I was getting ready to say something else. I won't say it because I don't know how everybody feel about that. But anyway, we just want you guys to always turn your focus back to Christ. Because like the song says, Jesus be the center of it all. That's what we all should strive for Jesus to be the center of everything that we do. Let Jesus be the center of it.
That's right. So again, in this time of Christmas, as we celebrate the birth of Christ, just remember to rejoice always, pray without ceasing, in everything give thanks, for this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
All right. Well, look, we love you, bless you, and can't wait to see you all. Miss you.
Yes. So have a very
Merry Christmas. Yes.
Love you guys.
All right.
Bye-bye.
From our home to your home, Merry Christmas and a Happy New Year.
From the long world, we love you.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Luke chapter 2. And it came to pass that in those days there went out a decree from Caesar Augustus that the world should be taxed, and that the taxing would be first made when Cyrenius was governor of Syria. And all went out to be taxed, everyone to his own city. And Joseph also went out of Galilee to the city of Nazareth, into Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house of David, to be taxed with Mary, his espoused wife, who was great with child. And so it was that while they were there, that the days had been accomplished that she should be delivered. And she brought forth her firstborn son and wrapped him in swaddling clothes and laid him in the manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. And there were in the same country shepherds abiding in the field, keeping watch over their flocks by night. And lo, the angel of the Lord came upon them, and the glory of the Lord shone round about them, and they were sore afraid. And the angel said unto them, Fear not, for behold, I bring good tidings of great joy, which shall be to all people. For unto you is born this day in the city of David a Savior, which is Christ the Lord. And this shall be a sign unto you. You shall find the babe wrapped in swaddling clothes and lying in a manger. And suddenly there was there with the angel a multitude of heavenly hosts, praising God, saying, Glory to God in the highest, and peace, goodwill towards all men. And it came to pass that when the angels were gone away from them into heaven, that the shepherds said to one another, Let us now go even unto Bethlehem and see this thing which has come to pass, which the Lord has made known. And they came with haste and found Mary and Joseph and the babe lying in a manger. Cliffdale, from the Goodman family to you, Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas, Cliffdale.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Well, hello, and Merry Christmas. Is everybody excited about Christmas this year? I know I am, because I actually get to spend it with my family this year. I mean, that's exciting to me. Amen. Well, as we shift gears and we go into the offering, I just want to remind you that just like it showed up there, there's so many ways that we can give here at Cliffdale. If you go to Cliffdale Alive, you know, it's really easy to remember, Cliffdale Alive. CliffdaleIsAlive.com. Seriously. And CliffdaleAlive.com, and there you can find our text to give number. You can also find a link that will take you to the Breeze website, and you'll be able to give that way. If you want to, you can bring your check by 6427 Cliffdale Road, Fayetteville, North Carolina, or you can drop your check off at the preschool, Building 5, to Barbara Wilson, Monday through Thursday, 9 a.m. through 3 p.m. Amen. And I don't know about you, but this is a season that makes me want to give. Amen. It really is. Hey, I was thinking about it, and you know, there's really a connection between giving and our relationship with God that many times we don't stop to think about. There's actually a connection in general between giving and relationships. If you look in the Bible, it says where your treasure is, there your heart will be also. You know, and the heart is the seat of who we are. It is the center of who we are. So if I want to know where my heart is, I can look at where my checkbook says my money has been going. Amen? You know, but the Bible also says that Jesus told us the number one commandment is thou shalt love the Lord thy God with all thy heart and with all thy soul and with all thy mind and with all thy strength. That's the number one commandment in Scripture. So my relationship with God is tied to my finances. It really is. You know, and this really shouldn't be a surprise. Sometimes we don't stop to think in terms of that way. But it really shouldn't be a surprise because our finances connected to other important relationships in our lives? I mean, come on, ladies, if that guy, you know, who you married had never came with any money or any gifts, would you really be married to him right now? I'm just saying. You know, and guys, you know, don't we go the extra effort for all those days, you know, Valentine's Day and birthday and Mother's Day? Why do we do that? Because we know if we show up, okay, and we don't have anything, that we're actually communicating something to our spouse that we really don't want to communicate. Amen? And if we think about it, it applies to our relationship with God, too. You know, the amount, every time we show up to God's house empty-handed, are we communicating to God something? You know? And is that really what we want to communicate to him? I mean, I don't know. When I think in terms like this, it challenges me to want to give more. You know, it challenges me to want to give, to put my tithes first before I pay any other bill. Because I want God to know that he has first place in my life. You know, and if God's going to have first place in my life, he's got to have first place in my checkbook as well. Amen. Now, in this season, what do we remember? Where God did not hold back. He did not, you know, he wasn't stingy when it came to us. You know, he pulled out all the stops. He sent his very, very best. So how can we do anything less when it's time for us to give to him? Amen. I just want you to consider those words as you prepare your heart to sow into the kingdom today. And so as the ushers go ahead and begin to come around, I'd like for everybody to stand up. And we're going to say a brief prayer, and then you're going to have the freedom to open your heart and to give. Amen. Father, we just thank you. Thank you for sending your very best. Thank you for not holding back, but giving your very best. And God, this holiday, this Christmas, and every day, we want to give our very best to you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Go ahead and ushers, you can go around and begin to collect the tithes and offerings. If you're giving online, you can go ahead and do that now. Hallelujah. Well, we've got some of the worship done, and now we're going to have a little bit of fun. Got the announcements we're going to do, and just got some good stuff prepared for everybody.
Ladies and gentlemen, this is Juan Burgundy reporting to give you the announcements.
Ushers, Ushers, can I get some help up here, please?
Security, we need to remove this man from the studio. Thank you very much.
Ushers, guys?
Merry Christmas to one and to everybody. My name is Homburg, and I'm giving you the news. I would like to remind everybody that we are doing an Advent devotional. So that means after service today, you need to pick up your addendum in the foyer, okay? Also, for the rest of the year, there will be no Wednesday night service because of COVID. So this Wednesday, the 23rd, there's no service because of COVID. And the following Wednesday, which is the 30th of December, there's no service because of COVID. Also, we have some other announcements, but I'd like to bring out a special guest anchor with us today, Miss DeWanda. Please give a warm, warm round of applause for DeWanda.
I'm back. And I'm ready. You ready for me?
Miss DeWanda, this is the news.
This is what?
This is the news. Oh. The news, yes.
Give me that. All right. I can do this.
Yes. All right.
So, did you announce this?
Yes, right okay. Here. Follow the teleprompter, please.
Okay, I'm gonna follow it. I can't see it. I don't know where. All right. So, all right.
Right there. Did you see it?
Oh, the one that says December.
No, that was mine. That's right here, Drew.
Oh, it says one.
No, right there.
It does not say the one.
Well, it's okay, right there.
Okay, whatever. Okay.
Just listen to me, please.
Okay. All right. December.
Are you okay to do this?
I am fine. Don't I
invited
look,
you back because people liked you, and I just want to make sure you're okay to
don't,
do this.
Don't I look fine to
okay.
do this?
Merry Christmas.
Okay, right all here. Right. December 31st. Ah! Yes! December 31st. That's what one person is excited. All right, so virtual watch night. Oh. That means that you have
Mr.
to.
Mr. Wanda. I have to say, I won't be there because of COVID.
Oh.
And I just want to say, I send my condolences to your king in Wakanda because I'm sure the watch night service is for the funeral. No.
First of all, we're gonna handle this right now. I am
For those of you that don't know, the Mr. Wanda is from Wakanda.
I am not from Wakanda. I am from New Jersey. I was born in New Jersey. Yes, I was born in Jersey.
Everybody knows New Jersey does not exist. I'm from New York, and I can tell you, New Jersey does not
yes,
exist.
Yes, Wakanda does not exist.
Wakanda is a very real place. You were born there, DeWanda.
I was not born in okay.
I suppose all right. Wakanda is all right. real all right. too, huh?
All right, so January.
So I won't be there for the Watch Night funeral service.
There is no Watch Night funeral. There is no Watch Night funeral. There's a Watch yes, Night service. It's virtual. You can... You can watch it.
But I won't be there to watch it because of COVID.
Okay, all right.
What time that starts? So I know not to be there.
It's going to start at 11.
At 11 p.m.
So you know not to want, okay, okay.
Merry Christmas.
Okay, yes. January the 20th, we have food distribution from 9 a.m. to 11.
I will be there.
You will?
Because there's food.
Yeah.
As long as you're 6 yards apart from me because of COVID, I will be there for the food.
I thought it was 6 feet.
6 yards.
6 yards?
That's what my mommy said.
Okay.
I had to stay safe and safe because of COVID.
Okay, that's why you've been gone?
That's why I've been
okay,
gone.
Okay, all right. You know, I've been down too.
So when's the food again?
It's on the 20th of January.
20th of January, ladies and gentlemen. Merry Christmas.
Okay, Merry... That's Happy New Year. Okay. All right. February the 7th, we have a new members class, all
because
right?
Because of COVID, ladies and gentlemen.
It is not because of COVID. It's because there's new members.
Okay.
All right. All
Brand
right.
new members.
All
but
right.
I won't be there. Do you know why?
Why?
Because it's my mommy's birthday.
Oh, okay. Okay. That's it. Okay. That makes sense. All right. She won't be there because of
COVID.
Okay, I know. That's the number. All right. So, and then we're going far off. We're going to go all the way to April the 4th, all right? Yep. There's going to be some Easter baptisms.
But there'll be no more COVID, right?
Hopefully.
Because I won't be there.
Oh, okay. COVID. All right. So, Juan, were you baptized?
Yes.
Of course.
Yeah.
Last night when I told my mommy I would be here, she threw me in a big bathtub full of alcohol just to make sure. And she'll probably do it again tonight.
She threw you in a big bath of alcohol.
She baptized me.
Wow. Oh.
Sana curito, sana de rana, si no hay sana hoy, sana
rana. Oh, that was that's a lot going on.
So Jess, I was baptized and I'll be baptized again tonight. Because you're not six joints.
That's not, but that's not what we do. I mean, like, if you want to be baptized, you know what, you know. All right.
A real baptism.
It's a real one. Real with one. Water, not alcohol.
Okay.
All right. So also, you got to check out that Daily Devo. How many of you guys are checking into that Daily Devo? All right.
On the book
aren't
face.
Aren't you?
It's on the book face.
It's on Facebook.
That's what I said, the book face.
Okay. Just in case, you know, it's every day around noonish, every day around noon. Just tune in and you get to see Pastor Josh.
Pastor
all right.
Josh.
I like it. I'm always tuned in to see, what's going to be said and what, new T-shirts are being worn because I'm all about fashion, as you can see.
Yes. Right. Speaking of Pastor Josh, we'd like to bring him out for a special segment we have today.
Yes.
To speak about Christmas traditions. Pastor Josh, please, a big round of applause.
All right.
Thank you.
Pastor Josh. Pastor Josh, before we begin, I just want to say Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
Now,
Feliz, the one
Feliz Navidad.
Feliz Navidad.
Yeah.
Muchas gracias.
Yes.
The one that being from Wakanda does not celebrate Christmas.
DeWanda, you?
I'm not from Wakanda.
Are you okay?
I'm not, what?
You look, I mean, girl, you look,
what?
Have you taken a trip to Wakanda recently?
I have not. I'm not, first of all, there's no Wakanda.
Yeah, I mean.
Second of all,
you
no.
look like, I mean, I heard about your king.
Don't talk, what?
And maybe that's why, are you in mourning?
I'm not in mourning. Are I you, mean, my, the, I don't have a king. What are you
Wakanda.
Talking about? Oh, y'all don't see my shirt.
Yeah.
I don't want to say anything, but he's right, you know.
Okay, but my thing is, I'm first of all, not from Wakanda. I'm not going to say it again. Okay?
Yeah.
I'm not going to say it again. I'm not from Wakanda. Where is Wakanda? Yeah. You tell me.
Africa.
Huh?
The Winter Soldier. You still got him there?
It's right next to Madagascar.
Yeah. Yeah.
It is not right next to Madagascar. Yeah. There is no...
Right to the left of Madagascar.
Just to the left.
Just to the left.
Just to the left.
Your directions are off. There is no... And what are you talking about?
Are you keeping the secret for
I'm not keeping any secret. First of all, this is the church. This is the house of God. And we're going to say the truth here. Okay? I am from New Jersey. One in the back.
Look.
And also from a made-up
Let me listen.
In the back.
I am recently become a doctor.
She's probably a cowboy.
What?
And I'm offering, my doctoral ability to help you if you need help. If you want to sit down.
Your people can make an appointment with his people.
Yeah. I'm here
about
for you.
About what?
About Wakanda.
There is no Wakanda. Okay?
Well,
we all were in mourning.
Uh-huh.
Don't talk about it.
Mm-hmm. See, there.
Okay.
Open up.
Look, I'm not even doing this.
The first step is sharing.
I'm done with y'all.
Sharing.
I'm done with y'all.
Sharing.
I am done with y'all.
Caring.
I'm out of here.
Merry Christmas.
Merry Christmas.
DeWanda.
DeWanda, ladies and gentlemen from Wakanda.
So, Pastor Yas, the real. Technical legal things. Yes. Pastor Yas, the real reason for the season is the 12 traditional days of Christmas.
Well, for me, one, I just, I look back. And it's like something just begins to come over me as I begin to consider the, spending days at my grandma Dina's house. And something just begins to come out of me, where suddenly I feel like I'm sitting there with my grandma once again. And every year, my friends, we would do the same thing, me and my grandma and my grandpapa, right? We would roll out the dough and make it in gnocchis. We would make it a sauce, and it was so good. But the very first day of Christmas, my Italian grandma made for me one ginormous meatball.
Very good. Pastor Yas, on the second day of Christmas, my abuela bring to me two khaki pants,
and one great Italian meatball. But on the third day of Christmas, my Italian grandma made for me three croquetas.
Two khaki pants.
And one Italian amito ball.
Pastor Yas, on the fourth day of Christmas.
Fourth day.
My abuela bring to me four bottles of horchata.
Horchata. Three croquetas.
Two khaki pants.
And one gigantic Italian amito ball.
How about the fifth day?
On the fifth day of Christmas, my grandma gave to me 5 cups of espresso,
4 bottles of horchata,
3 croquetas,
2 khaki pants,
and 1 gigantic Italian meatball. With the cheese, please.
With the cheese. On the 6th day of Christmas, my abuela ring to me 6 ice cold cervezas.
Cerveza. Five espresso. Ah, yes, there.
4 bottles of horchata.
3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball. On the 7th day, yes, the 7th day of Christmas, my grandma gave to me 7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 espresso.
4 bottles of horchata.
3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball.
On the 8th day of Christmas, my abuela ring to me, and my abuelo too. 8 bottles chili.
7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 espresso.
4 bottles of horchata.
Horchata, yes, very good. 3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball. With the cheese, please.
With the cheese. On the 9th day of Christmas, Pastor Yash.
On the 9th day of Christmas, are you ready for this? My grandma gave to me 9 cannolis. Leave it a gun. Bring it a cannoli.
Bring it the cannoli. Leave it a gun. With 8 bottles chili.
7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 es.
Café con leche.
Espressos. Thank you.
4 bottles of horchata.
3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball. With the cheese, please.
On the 10th day of Christmas, my abuela ring to me. 10 horn tamales.
Tamales, también. Buena, buena. 9 cannolis. Leave it a gun. Bring it a cannoli, please.
8 bottles chili.
7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 espressos.
6 cold cervezas.
You said that one. 4 horchata. 3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball. Oh, with the cheese.
With the cheese. On the 11th day of Christmas, Pastor.
On the 11th day of... Are you ready for this?
I'm ready.
On the 11th day of Christmas, my grandma gave to me, and my grandpapa, and my aunt, and my uncle, they give me 11. Forget about it, okay?
11.
Forget about it. Forget about it.
You forget about it.
You forget. I got more goo. Forget about it. 9... Cannolis, leave it a gun, bring it a cannoli.
8 bottles chili.
7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 espressos.
4 bottles of horchata.
3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 gigantic Italian meatball with the sauce and the cheese and the pasta the and the whole thing.
On the 12th day of Christmas, my abuela ring to me. 12 shots of tequila.
I told you already, I am a doctor. If you need to sit down and talk about all this alcohol, you know.
It's for cooking.
cooking with tequila?
I'll tell her to bring me 12 taquitos.
Yeah, taquitos, that's a little bit better.
12 warm taquitos.
7 or 11, forget about it, forget about it, forget about it.
10 warm tamales.
9, I forgot. Cannolis.
Cannolis.
You can hold the cannoli. Don't forget the cannolis. Leave it the gun. Bring it the cannolis.
Bring it the cannolis.
You got it. Thank you very much. 7 plates of pasta.
6 cold cervezas.
5 espressos.
Café con leche. 4 bottles of horchata.
3 croquetas.
2 khaki pants.
And 1 Italian meatball. Ladies and gentlemen, give it up for Juan Burgundy.
And then Pastor Yas, thank you very much. Feliz Navidad. Just a spicy Cliffdale.
Hi, guys.
What's up,
Woo, woo. I am so excited.
Yes, we're going to talk about Christmas.
Hallelujah.
Yes, Christmas. Christmas tree. Oh, Christmas tree.
I don't want to sing about the Christmas tree.
Oh, okay. What are we talking about then?
Well, it's Christmas, so you know what that means.
I don't know what that mean. Is that the day that Jesus born?
That's right.
Oh, well, glory.
That's
glory.
Why I'm so excited.
Yes. Well, Kevin, we're supposed to be talking about the reason for the season.
They got a song about that, right?
Oh, Lord, yes. You know it?
What's the song?
That song that little short guy sing. He say, Jesus is the reason for the season. Yes, he is. Oh, yes, he is.
I love it when you call him my savior.
Yes.
That's my favorite part.
Yes, I love it. I love it, Kevin. That's like one of my favorite Christmas songs.
Yeah, that's right. Y'all thought I was excited about these presents up here, but that's not why I'm excited. I'm excited because it's Jesus' birth. Well, we celebrate Jesus' birthday.
Yes, because I don't think they're too sure about when Jesus was actually born, but December the 25th has been the date picked. So we celebrate the birth of Christ.
That's right.
Do you guys know what that means? Kevin?
Of course.
All right, Kevin, tell him.
You said it's his birthday, so that's when he was born. That's what we celebrate.
Lord Hammers. Kevin, we're talking about the meaning of Christ's birth. What did that really mean, Kevin?
It means that we celebrating the fact that God gave us a Savior.
Yes.
Savior. Savior. He's my Savior. Ooh, yes, he's my Savior, Kevin.
That's anointed right there.
He's my Savior.
That's anointed. But look, we don't have a lot of time. We gotta go.
Oh, that's right, that's right. Okay, guys, so please don't forget that Jesus is the reason for the season. Yes, he is.
Why you stop?
I wait for you to say, oh, yes, he is.
I love it when they call him my savior. Yeah,
that's right.
Well, before we go, I just want to say I've been studying Spanish. And my teacher told me how to say Merry Christmas in Spanish.
Oh, okay. Go ahead now.
Felix never did.
What?
Felix never did.
Kevin!
She said, Felix never did. I said, Felix never did what?
Oh, Kevin, you are so funny. No, Kevin, it's Feliz Navidad.
Oh, Feliz Navidad.
Yes. Who did y'all say Feliz Navidad? Ooh, glory to God. Well, children, I'm so sorry for Kevin messing up the Spanish language today. But we just want y'all to know that Jesus is the reason for the season, yeah.
Yes, he is.
Oh, yes, he is.
I love it when you call him my savior.
Yes.
Give it up once again, ladies and gentlemen, for Kevin and Chip. 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 Woo, hallelujah. If you have your Bibles, go ahead and turn with me to John chapter 3 and verse 16. You know, of course, we are entering into the week where our theme, our focus is love during this season of Advent. And as we do that, those of you who know me know that if I had a life sermon, the sermon would be in regards to love. Loving the Lord our God with all of our heart, all of our soul, all of our mind, all of our strength, and loving our neighbor as ourself. As Jesus says, this was the great command, the greatest commandment that we as believers do that. And John chapter 3 and verse 16 is probably one of the most familiar portions of Scripture. But today, hopefully, I will bring just a little light on this so familiar portion of Scripture. John 3, I'm going to read 16 through 19, where it says, "For God so loved the world that He gave His only begotten Son, that whoever believes in Him should not perish, but have everlasting life. For God did not send His Son into the world to condemn the world, but that the world through Him might be saved. He who believes in Him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is already or condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that the light has come into the world, and men loved darkness rather than light, because their deeds were evil." Heavenly Father, we come before You this morning, and Father, I just first off thank You for sending Your Son to come into this world, that You indeed so did so love the world that You sent Your most prized and precious possession, Your own Son, to come into the world to heal this world, to save this world, preserve and deliver this world. And so as we continue this celebration, the celebration of the birth of Your Son, Father, we also acknowledge what that birth means, the promise that was given, the promises that were fulfilled through His life, His death, His birth, burial, resurrection, ascension. In Jesus' name, amen. You know, as we look at the word loved, for God so loved the world, it is the word agapeo. Now, we know that word because of the word agape, the derivative, or the word that that agapeo is derived from is the word agape. And this is the same love that is spoken of in 1 Corinthians chapter 13, where Paul, writing to the church at Corinth, says, "Look, though I have the tongue of men and of angels, but have not love, I am nothing. Though I give my body to be burned and all my riches to feed the poor, and have not love, I am nothing." And then he goes on to say how love stands fast, and love never quits, it never stops, it's never puffed up, it never fails. This is the God kind and God quality of love. And the word agapeo goes a little further. It is to welcome, to entertain, to be fond of, to love dearly, to be well pleased with, to contend at or for a thing. And then we take a look at what God loved, and that is the world. And those of you, I can remember several years ago, my dad preaching on the word world and its meaning. And if you look at the word world in this portion of Scripture, it is the word cosmos. Now, cosmos does mean the cosmos, the universe. It does mean time and space, the earth, the people, and all of these things the cosmos does mean. But first and foremost, before it means those things, the primary meaning of the word cosmos is the orderly arrangement of things, the preordained set order of all things. You see, a lot of times when we consider the word cosmos, or we consider the word world, we consider ourselves, for God so loved you, and He so loved you, and He so loved you, and He so loved you, and you, and you. And I don't diminish that at all. But also, now let's have our understanding kind of expanded and realize it's not only that He loved you, and He loved you, and He loved you, and He loved you, but He also loved the pre-arranged set order of things. Now, why does God love the pre-arranged set order of things? Because God, in His infinite will, in His infinite power, in His infinite knowledge, knows me and you, this world, the cosmos, better than we know ourselves. His understanding goes further, farther. We may think we know what's best for ourselves. We may think that we know what is best, what our deepest desires are. But oftentimes, those things are based in feelings, and we shared this last week when we were talking about joy, because we realized last week that joy is not a feeling, it's a choice. That hope is not a feeling, it is a choice. That peace is not a feeling, It is a choice. And love also is not a feeling. It is a choice. And the reality, the really real of it is, God knows what's better for us. God knows better than we do the things that are going to bring us peace, happiness, destiny, the things that are going to bring us joy, satisfaction. He knows each one of those things. So the very first thing we got to do, right, is we've got to completely just say, okay, I'm going to take everything that I know that I personally want, and I'm just going to move it off the table. I'm not going to say that those things won't come back onto the table, but very first thing, I'm going to just completely empty out the glass. Okay, all my personal wants and desires, I realize, okay, God knows me better than I know myself, so I'm just going to take those and I'm just going to dump them all out. And now I'm going to go to my Heavenly Father and say, Father, being that you know me better than I know me, being that you know the preordained set order of things in my life, my family's life, my friend's life, my city's life, my church's life, being that you know all of these things better than we know them, I'm going to go back to the starting line, realize that you loved that preordained set order of things. You loved the cosmos so much that you sent your only begotten Son. And sent his only begotten Son, why? He sent his only begotten Son to purchase back that preordained set order of things. He sent his only Son to redeem the best you there could possibly be. And I'm not going to preach some greasy grace sort of message right now, but we just need to realize, like I said, him knowing us better than we know ourselves, his way being better than our ways, if we ever hope to realize the things that he has for us, what Jesus has purchased for us, we've got to pour out our own wants, desires, and say, okay, now Heavenly Father, I'm emptied of myself. Now, whatever you want me to be, you make that in me, because I realize I will never experience true joy or satisfaction until I step into that preordained set order of things. Are you following me, church? I will never discover true satisfaction, peace, joy. I will never step into the fullness of what you have for me if I'm always just trying to take what I want. Me, 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 I. Galatians says it. If we sow to the flesh, from the flesh, we will reap destruction. But if we sow to the Spirit, from the Spirit, we will reap eternal life. So as long as I'm going after my desires, talked about it last week, right? As long as I continue to go for all the things I want, my lusts, my desires, me, 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 I feel like if I just had this, or if I feel like if I just had that, if I feel like if I could just get my hands on, or if I could just buy, I feel like that would be it. But you know, if you've ever, listen, the more you heap upon that, or the more you pour, right? The more you give the desires of the lust of your flesh, the more it wants. Those lusts are never satisfied. They'll tell you, listen, if I could just have that $1,000, I would be good to go. It would be smooth. If I could just have that $10,000, if I could just have that $100,000, hear me, friends, if I could just have that new house or new boat, that new car, if I could just have this guy or this gal, or if I could just, any one of those things, right, that myself is telling me that I need, that I want, as soon as I get those things, I come to the realization that my flesh always, 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 always wants more. I can never feed my flesh enough to satisfy it. Why? Because as long as I am feeding my flesh, it will never be satisfied. It's when I step into the preordained set order, the prearrangement that my Heavenly Father has for me, it is once I step into those things that I begin to realize and know true satisfaction. I begin to realize and know true joy and true peace. And the cool part about that, guys, listen, and this is so good, because this is why God sent his only begotten Son. That as I begin to build my life and establish my life on the foundation, that preordained set order of things, is once I begin to build my life on that and begin to truly experience joy and peace, then even when the storms come, even when situations, even if I lose all of those desires that my flesh wanted, I lose the house, I lose the car, right? I lose the money, I lose this, I lose that, all those things my flesh said I needed, as long as I am founded on Jesus as that foundation, the one who God sent to purchase back that preordained set order of things, as long as I'm founded, the storms can roll in. The lightning can strike, man, the wind can blow, and the rain can fall, and the waves can crash, but I will not be moved. I will, in that situation, be able to maintain my peace, my joy, my hope, my love. Why? Because my life is not founded on all that stuff, but it's founded on Jesus, that preordained set order of things. He goes on to say that he who believes in him would not perish. The word perish is apolamei, and it's the word that we get apocalyptic from. And it is to destroy, to put out of the way entirely, to abolish, to put to an end, to ruin, to kill, to devote. This is harsh, guys. It's the Strong's Concordance that says this. To devote or give over to eternal misery in hell. Ow! What? Whoever believes, now this, what this tells me is whoever does not believe in him will perish, right? They will experience this eternal death in hell. But whoever does believe in him will not perish. They will not experience those things, but instead these individuals will experience what? Life. The word life, many of us already know, is the word zoe. This is the absolute fullness of life, both essential and ethical, which belongs to God. It is real life. It is genuine. It is active. It is vigorous. It is devoted to God. Blessed. It is the proportion that Christ purchased for the world by dying on Calvary's cross. It is the resurrected life that lasts forever and ever and ever and never stops. Now, I want to pose a question, and I won't keep you guys too much longer, maybe 5 more, 10 more minutes, but we know that Jesus came so we would not perish or have that eternal hell, but to reestablish the preordained set order of things. We realize that, okay, and so that we might have that life, that everlasting life, that God quality zoe life. Question. When does eternal life, everlasting life, when does it begin? Think about this. If I receive my salvation and thereby receive eternal life, receive that God quality of life, all of those promises that we just talked about, right? When does that everlasting life begin? Some might say, well, Pastor Josh, it begins upon the point of death. Well, no, because if it begins upon the point of death, it's not everlasting. It's not eternal. Because eternity doesn't just stretch into the future. It also stretches to the past. It is space and time unlimited. So if God so loved the preordained set order of things, and I'm going to go a little mind blown, right? So if God so loved the preordained set order of things that he gave his only begotten son that we would not have to perish, right? Or have eternal misery in hell, being death and dead and all, but that we might have everlasting and eternal life, and all that that God quality of life means, then when does that life begin? That life has already begun and already exists. It's up to us when we're going to begin to receive it. See, God's quality of life has already been purchased for you. It's already been bought. Now, you see, the common mistake that we make is we think that the preordained set order of things includes me having everything that I want. We think that that's God's promise. He promises me the boat and the car and the money, all of these things. But my friends, I say that's from an earthly perspective. And what we got to begin to do is have a heavenly perspective. Realize those things, they're nice and they're comfortable. They may be fun, right? But God, his vision, his insight goes further and farther than all of that. His says, you know what? In the midst of the storm, you're going to be founded in peace and you won't be shaken. Let's break it down and bring it home. In the midst of people dying tragically, you're going to be all right. In the midst of COVID and pandemic and politics and circumstance and situations, you're going to be able to stand strong. Why? Because you are founded on the preordained set order of things. You have found your foundation in me and in who I am. And no matter what happens in all the world out there, you, because he so loved you and you and you and you are fixed in the preordained, predestined, set order, ordained things. And that's already begun because you've already begun to receive it. So you've already begun to walk and live in a life that is eternal. It doesn't stop and it doesn't quit. Go on to John 3, 18 and 19. He says, "He who believes in him is not condemned. But he who does not believe is condemned already." And this goes back to what I was talking about, right? Either the eternal life or the eternal death, that's already, it's eternal. It exists in a place outside of time. When we as humans begin to consider time, we think of this linear, you're born, you live, you get married, you know, whatever, you have babies, you grow old, you have grandbabies, you retire, you go on, and finally, at the end of it, is death, and then you have eternity after that. And my friends, I beg to differ. I believe the Hebraic kind of mindset is a little bit more accurate to God's, though not entirely, and they believe more in a secular or a circle sort of lifespan, that we have opportunities in our life, and those opportunities are not once in a lifetime, but God will offer those opportunities multiple times in our life in order to, and I believe that that's, again, that's not the fullness of eternity by any means, but I believe that gives us a better look than the linear outlook. Are you following me? This is awful deep for a Christmas cantata, isn't it? I'm not sorry. Amen. He who believes in him is not condemned, but he who does not believe is condemned already, because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son of God. And this is the condemnation, that light is coming to the world, and men, right, full circle, y'all, men loved darkness, or they loved the unarranged, unordained order of confusion and chaos, darkness, they loved that chaos more then they love the light. Because, why? Because their deeds were evil. See, these individuals who are moving to that place of condemnation, right? These individuals who are walking in that darkness, I almost feel bad for them, because what they actually believe, right? They actually believe that as long as they continue to feed the flesh, the desires of the flesh, that one day the flesh will be satisfied. They believe as long as I can just give it, that one day, I will find, I finally got enough and I am satisfied. Miss Barbara girl? No, Jessica, you're the one I want to talk to. You posted these pictures of this etouffee you made, right? And I'm just going to be real with you. That caused me to get this spirit. I fed my flesh, I'm not going to lie. I had this spirit of indulging. And so I said to myself, I had a pound of shrimp and a pound of scallops, right? And I said to myself, self, maybe I'll fry these scallops up. Maybe I'll fry these shrimp up. And then I remembered this post I saw on Food Wars 2020. And I said to myself, self, ooh-wee. You know what would be better than some fried scallops and some fried shrimp? Some seafood etouffee. Hey now. I blame Jessica. It is your fault, young lady, that I indulged my flesh to the point of gluttony. And you need to repent for that, John. We'll talk about it later. We'll go to the cross with it. Look, y'all, and it wasn't bad the first night I ate it, because, you know, I was able to overcome the power of the lust of my flesh. But then I had leftovers last night, right? And look, I lay down in my bed and said, oh, Lord Jesus, help me. Father, I've sinned. Please, Lord, forgive my sin and ease my pain. Woo! It's a funny thing, though. Even as much as I fed my flesh last night, I woke up this morning hungry, and I had just a little bit of etouffee left, but I didn't eat it, because I don't eat before church because I can't. Woo! He who does not believe is condemned already. Why do I say all of that? I say that because we may think that these things are going to bring us joy and bring us happiness, but they don't. We don't find happiness, joy, satisfaction in the midst of the chaos and confusion and darkness. We find it in the preordained set order of things. John writes in 1 John chapter 4, "Beloved, let us love one another, for love is of God. And everyone who loves is born of God and knows God. He who does not love does not know God, for God is love. In this, the love of God was manifest toward us, that God has sent his only Son into the world that we might live through him. Again, the word live is derived from the word zoi, okay? In this is love, not that we loved God, but that he has loved us and sent his own son as the propitiation for our sin. Beloved, if God so loved us, we ought also to love one another. No one has seen God at any time, and if we love one another, God abides in us, and his love has been perfected in us. And I'm going to close, so just stay with me for another two or three more minutes. By this we know and abide in him, and he in us, because he has given us his Spirit. And we have seen and do testify that the Father has sent the Son as Savior of the world. Whoever confesses that Jesus is the Son of God, God abides in him, and he in God. And we have known and believed the love that God has for us. God is love. And he who abides in love abides in God, and God in him. Now I want us to stop and consider for a moment. Because Jesus made all of these very radical, very difficult commands. Not only telling us to love the Lord our God with all our heart, soul, mind, and strength. Telling us to love our neighbor. But man, he took it so far as to say we had to love our enemies. Now, you cannot tell me each and every individual has individuals in their life currently right now that they are finding very difficult and challenging to love. And understand, my wife, she just brought a group of individuals through this book called The Blessing of Brokenness. And understand that until our cup is completely poured out, until we allow ourselves to be broken, right, we will never be put back together. The cup can never be filled back up. Now, I'm not talking about broken as in weeping and crying and being broke. I'm talking about broken as in saying, Father, I need to be emptied out so I can be filled back up with you. I need to be taken apart and put back together properly. I realize, Heavenly Father, that the preordained set order of things in my life currently is not applied. And so there are some things that are out of order that, Jesus, you came to fix. And that, Heavenly Father, you so loved this preordained set order of things in my life that you sent your only Son, so I didn't have to remain in that place of confusion any longer, but I could allow you to break me and move those things to the place they need to be. Why do I say all of that? I say all of that to say this. The reason why we find it so challenging to love certain individuals is not, tuck your toes, is not because of them. But it's because of you. Because you have things in your life that are out of order, that God desires to put back into the preordained, set, proper order of things. See, because once he puts those pieces back where they need to be, we'll come to the fuller realization that it's so much easier to hate the sin and still love the sinner. See, because that's what God does. God loves every sinner that has ever lived. That is what he is. It is who he is. What he does not love is the sin. And even more than just not loving the sin, because he doesn't just hate the sin for hating the sin. What he really hates is the sin and the effect that the sin has on you. He realizes that that preordained set order of things, that sin rearranges those things, confuses, bringing chaos to those things, thereby bringing dissatisfaction, uneasiness, fear, pain into your life. And he does not desire that you live in that fear and that pain, that difficulty and that hardship. He realizes the way he made you, shaped you, created you, the preordained set order of things, and that's where he desires that you live. But he also realizes that in order for those things to be put into place, we must come to the point in our lives where we're willing to be poured out, we're willing to be broken, so that he might put us back together again. Then, my friends, then we will learn what it is to truly, truly love one another. Then we'll truly learn what it is, right? Not just to love one another, to love him, but then we'll realize that preordained set order of things and how we can find true joy and satisfaction, not just in ourselves, but in who he is. Amen? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we love you. And God, we bless you today. We glorify and we honor you. And Father, we say, have your way on the inside of us today. As Father, we do these closing two songs. We acknowledge you in that preordained set order of things in our life. And say, have your way, God. Break us and make us new. Let us realize that we were made, that preordained set order of things is to love and to have joy and peace. and hope. We love you, Lord. And we thank you for the gift that is the birth of your only begotten Son. In Jesus' name, amen. Church, let's go ahead and stand once again. Hallelujah.
Praise His holy name.
love you, God.
Father, we love you, and God, we bless you. We thank you, Jesus, that you indeed are the reason for the season, and we celebrate who you are. Everybody in the house, just lift up both hands. I say, may the Lord bless you. May he keep you and cause his glorious countenance to shine upon you. As we close out 2020 and begin to look at entering into 2021, may that carry with it God's blessings of strength and life and prosperity and goodness. In Jesus' name, yes. Amen. Come on, everybody, give a hand clap of praise. You are dismissed. We love you guys.
We give you all the glory.
To be praised.